HarperCollins presents The New House by Tess Stimson, read by Penelope Rawlins. For my mother Jane, my father Michael, my sweet sister Philippa, and beloved brother Charles, holding you all in my heart until we're together again. Part 1. Chapter 1. Millie. The silence of a house that's been broken into is unlike any other. It's as if you've flipped up its skirts and made it gasp, taking all the air with it. Those first few stolen seconds of stillness are like a drug to me. I could spend a lifetime in this moment, at peace. But it doesn't last long. It's broken by the soft patter of feline paws running down the hallway. A grey cat slinks into the laundry room, ignoring me completely as she heads to her bowl. She isn't the least bit interested in me or what I'm doing in her house. Cats have refined survival of the species to an efficient minimalism. Even the most self-absorbed cat will nurture her own kittens, but by the time they're 8 weeks old, the mother, having accomplished the important work of teaching them independence, is done with them. She'll still intervene if they're in trouble or get too rough in play, but she won't interact with them on a regular basis. She'll swat a youngster who disturbs her rest, and once they reach adolescence, at around 12 weeks, it's every cat for herself. The mother will hiss if they come near her food. She won't grieve when they disappear from the home. In fact, she'll be relieved. We don't blame a cat for being a cat.
You knew what you were getting into, Tom says. You're an intelligent woman. You knew what having children would mean.
The cat twines herself in a figure eight around my legs, seeking more food. I pick her up, stroking the back of her head, enjoying the sensual pleasure of her fur beneath my fingers as I wander into the kitchen. I had high hopes for this property, but it looked a lot better on Rightmove than it does in person. The pictures were clearly taken with a wide-angle lens and then photoshopped. The kitchen has very little natural light, and even on a bright morning like this, it feels dingy. The owners obviously renovated before putting the house on the market. The house smells of paint, but they've made the same mistake most people do when they remodel a kitchen. They've upgraded the cabinets and appliances, but kept the same inefficient, dated layout. It's nicely done, with granite countertops and interesting stainless steel backsplashes, but the way people live has changed a lot in the last few decades. A kitchen isn't just where you cook anymore, but where you live. They should have taken down that wall to the dining room. Who actually uses a dining room these days? And created one large open plan space. It would have given them a lot of natural light too, from the west-facing front of the house, and they could have put in some French doors at the back to get that indoor-outdoor feel. I check out the cupboards. Emma Bridgewater crockery. Yawn. Expensive Le Creuset saucepans, but cheap knives, which tells me everything I need to know about the people who own this house. Upstairs is equally disappointing, a cramped fifth bedroom that should have been used to expand the master bathroom, or better yet, create a decent walk-in wardrobe. Original features no one's had the courage to either eliminate completely or assimilate into the new design. None of the beds are made. The cupboard doors in the master bedroom are flung wide, as if they've left in a hurry. Her sweaters are neatly folded in colour-coded stacks, but his side of the wardrobe is a tangled mess, with ties dribbling down the shelves and balled-up socks on the floor. In my experience, incompatibility in a wardrobe is a more reliable indicator of divorce than infidelity. I open the cabinet in their ensuite bathroom, scrutinising the prescription labels. She's had two bouts of cystitis recently. He's got bad hemorrhoids. She's missed a couple of her contraceptive pills this month. I wonder if her husband knows that. Bored, suddenly, I go back downstairs and scan the knickknacks on the bookshelves in the sitting room, looking for a souvenir before I leave. I never take anything valuable or clearly sentimental. A fridge magnet, a bulldog clip, nothing that will be missed. There was a time I broke into houses on a weekly basis. Whenever life got too complicated, I'd slip away and disappear into the silence of a house that wasn't mine. I'd spend hours in other people's homes, perusing their wardrobes, reading their books. I find it profoundly soothing to exist in a world where I'm not supposed to be, for reasons I've never been able to explain. It's been months since I allowed my darker self to call the shots, but I'm tense and exhausted. Some people drink or take drugs to relax. This is my addiction. I know what I'm doing is wrong. I'm violating someone's private sanctuary. But I only visit houses that have been put up for sale, whose owners are inviting scrutiny. I'm careful never to leave a trace of my presence. I made a promise, and I never break my word. First, do no harm. For a moment, I consider taking one of the photographs. Mr. and Mrs. Unmade Bed with their two children, boy and girl. Here they are on their ski break in Zermatt. Oh, look. Boy and girl have a new puppy. Dog. Look, dog, look. They make family life seem so easy. In the end, I slip one of a pair of dice into my pocket and go back through the kitchen, leaving via the same back door in the laundry room as I came in. I even lock it behind me, which is more than the owners remember to do. Set Talks, Psychology Series, Science, Entertainment, Technology. Inside the Mind of a Psychopath. Original air date, the 9th of July. The transcript below has been lightly edited for length and clarity.
I appreciate the introduction, Ken, but I'm guessing you all know who I am, or you wouldn't be here.
Laughter.
I know you're all desperate to get to the juicy stuff, the glasshouse murders, and we will soon, I promise. But this talk is supposed to be educational, so let's kick off with a statistic. 1 in 100 normal people, and I'm putting normal in inverted commas here, is a psychopath. I can see you all doing the math, so let me save you the trouble. There's about 1,000 of you in this room. So that means roughly 10 of you are psychopaths. But since the stat I just gave you rises to 1 in 25 when we're talking about business leaders and CEOs, we've probably got about 40 psychos in here this evening. It could be carnage by the end of the night.
Laughter.
But let's get serious for a minute. It's essential you approach this subject with something other than a pop culture understanding of psychopathy. Think of it as Psycho 101. I'll do my best to make it as painless as possible. Thanks to Hollywood, when you hear the term psychopath, you imagine a knife-wielding maniac with crazy eyes. Jack Nicholson in The Shining, Hannibal Lecter in The Silence of the Lambs, Norman Bates in Psycho. Well, I guess the clue's in the name with that last one.
Laughter.
But what about this young lady who looks like Sandra Bullock sitting here in the front row? If you could just stand up. Thank you. Lovely sweater, by the way. Looks like butter wouldn't melt, doesn't she? The archetypal girl next door. But trust me, she's the one you need to be scared of.
Laughter.
Well, not literally. Thank you, Miss Bullock. You can sit down now. My point is, not all psychopaths are wild-eyed serial killers. It's a spectrum disorder, like autism. At one end, you've got Ted Bundy and Charles Manson and Jack the Ripper, Hollywood's bloodthirsty predators. And at the other, you've got the brain surgeons and TV presenters and tech moguls and corporate business leaders. The people everyone needs to be ruthless and focused and unemotional in a crisis. people like me. When I tell people I'm a psychopath, their response is usually a mix of horror and fascination. I mean, who admits to being deceptive, callous, manipulative, reckless, superficial, predatory, right?
Laughter.
And I'm not going to lie to you, I'm all of those things. You'd think it'd put people off me, but no. You might be nervous, but you're riveted and excited too, aren't you? And why wouldn't you be? I'm extremely charming when I want to be. I'm well-liked, I have lots of friends. Functionally, I'm a good person. I'm one of the safe ones. I love to cook, and I've got a dark sense of humour. I often make people laugh. People come to me with their troubles. So, what makes me so different from most of you? Well, I'm not going to bore you with lots of science about the amygdala and the orbital frontal cortex, but the bottom line is, psychopaths, like me, are biologically incapable of empathy. A dozen scientific studies have confirmed it. We literally can't feel your pain. We don't experience fear or remorse, so we don't care about blending into society. We're not bothered by punishment or disapproval. It's a miracle more of us aren't serial killers, to be honest. We'll lie and cheat to get what we want, but we don't make moral choices, we make pragmatic ones. Usually, we're not out to get you. We're like water. We'll always find the quickest and easiest route to where we want to be. And if you get in our way, you'll be washed away. But we're as capable of love and nurturing as we are indifference and destruction. Most of us aren't a threat. Remorse and empathy may not come naturally to us, but we can learn to care. It takes practice. It's like learning a different language, and it's exhausting. But we want to fit in. We want to be good people, and so we work at it. Like I said, usually we're not out to get you. Usually. A small minority of psychopaths have a predisposition to calculated violence. Violence that's cold-blooded and planned and scary as hell. I'm as terrified of people like that as you are. It's not like psychos give each other a hall pass. I'm often asked how something as ordinary as moving house descended into such chaos and bloodshed. And the truth is, I honestly don't know. Hindsight is a wonderful thing, and with retrospect, the signs were there. You'd think someone like me would have been able to spot them, but at the time, we had no reason to suspect anything. We just wanted to sell our house.
Chapter 2. Millie. By the time I get back home, Tom is in the kitchen, organizing breakfast, packed lunches, the day. Our lives.
How was your run?
He asks me. Good. Just what I needed. Tom and I have been married for 19 years. He knows it's not the run that's rejuvenated me and put a spring in my step. I left a bouquet of pink roses on the doorstep of the house I borrowed to say thank you to the owners, with a cryptic note, pay it forward. They'll be confused, but I hope the flowers will make them as happy as the house made me. I hand Tom the dice I stole earlier as he puts two slices of whole wheat bread into the toaster. I don't permit white bread in the house. Or sugar, crisps, fizzy drinks. No screens at the table or in bed. Tom pockets the dice without comment. Later, he'll add it to the other mementos of my extracurricular activities that he keeps in a drawer beneath his desk. I'm like a cat, bringing home a mouse as proof of my hunting skills. Proof I still have my darker impulses in check. The kids tumble down the stairs, already bickering and shoving at each other as they tussle for stools at the breakfast bar. Medusa, our daughter, is 13, clear-eyed and knowing. She's inherited Tom's black Irish hair and blue eyes, but in every other respect, she takes after me. Sometimes this makes me sad. Sometimes not. Naming her was my privilege. Part of the deal Tom and I struck when we decided to have a child. I'd planned to call her Artemis, after the Greek goddess of the hunt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.